Pencils are ubiquitous, and they're hexagons. So today I present to you a long overdue video on pencils and hexagons. Our goal today is to find the terminal velocity of a pencil as it rolls down a slope. Right now you might be wondering why a pencil even has a terminal velocity in the first place. That'll soon be explained after I explain the problem statement. Or pause the video now and try to figure it out on your own. So here's the setup, which is pretty basic. We have an inclined plane, which is angled at theta to the horizontal. And we have a pencil, whose long side is parallel to the non-angled part of the plane as shown, and has a side length r. Then the pencil is given a kick, and it begins rolling. Our question is, what is the terminal velocity of this pencil? First, let's clarify a few things about this setup. We'll assume that the inclined plane is at an angle shallow enough such that the pencil is always in contact with the plane, it doesn't fly off. We'll also assume that the coefficient of friction is high enough such that the pencil does not slip. That is, as seen in the previous animation, the hexagon is essentially always rotating about one of its vertices. Lastly, we'll model the pencil as having all of its mass concentrated at center for simplicity of calculations. Alright, now that we've got that out of the way, we can get to solving the problem. At this point, I encourage you to try to solve it on your own before watching the rest, if you want. Now let's take a moment to discuss why the pencil reaches a terminal velocity in the first place. Take a moment to ponder that on your own. For example, a sphere or cylinder rolling down dozens, they uniformly accelerate until the bottom, gradually picking up speed. The reason this pencil reaches a terminal velocity is because of the stipulation that it doesn't slip. That is, when it has to change axes as its second end contacts the plane, there's a frictional impulse that has to change the movement of the hexagon in order to change its rotational axis. If we pause here, the first axis before it collides is the green one, and the hexagon has picked up speed, but the inelastic collision that occurs right afterward means that as it changes to the blue axis, velocity as seen by the blue vector is reduced. This causes the loss of energy which is responsible for the terminal velocity. One way to say this is the gravitational potential energy that the pencil loses as it moves down is converted by friction into heat rather than kinetic energy. So now that we have this qualitative perspective out of the way, let's determine this terminal velocity. The general idea for doing this, and this is a bit tricky, is to say at some speed, when it goes through this sort of periodic behavior, it returns to the same speed. This is the steady state speed, because once the pencil reaches this speed, then it won't get any faster since it will be stuck in this loop. So we have to find the speed just after a collision, such that the speed remains the same just after the next collision. So we have to first get to this collision to find the relation for this. Well, let's pause here, right before the collision. Let V not be this steady state velocity. First, we have to find the velocity just before this next collision in order to relate to V not to the velocity after the collision, which is what we ultimately want to do, set them equal. So then we have to write a conservation of energy equation to find the magnitude of this green velocity vector. Let this velocity be V sub f. Now for conservation of energy, we need to know the mass distribution of the pencil since there's a rotational component to this energy. However, as stated earlier, to make the final calculations nice, and since it doesn't really change any part of the solution besides the calculations, we say that the entire mass is concentrated in the lead of the pencil. Then the kinetic energy is simply the classic 1f mv squared, and we can equate the change in this to the change in the gravitational potential energy. Now to get this change in gravitational potential energy, we can simply draw a couple of lines. Now there is a nice symmetry to the setup. Since the hexagon is simply shifted down, the displacement vector is parallel to the plane. And using the equilateral triangle shown, this means that the change in gravitational potential energy is simply mgr sine theta. Thus, we can write that 1 half mv sub f squared, the velocity just before the next collision, minus 1 half mv naught squared is equal to mgr sine theta. Now to find the steady state velocity, we need to find the relation at the collision since we've only made it up to the point just before it. We employ the conservation of angular momentum specifically about the marked blue points. You might be wondering, wait, how can we conserve angular momentum? We have an external torque due to gravity. Well, if we think about that torque as the rate of change of angular momentum, the instantaneous collision, gravity isn't going to change this angular momentum since it is instantaneous, so we can use conservation. To write this relation, note that the blue velocity, the velocity after the collision, must be V0 by the steady state idea. So we write R sub F cross V sub F is equal to R sub naught cross V naught. So now with a bit of geometry, we can write these cross products nicely. Looking at the dotted line, the quote-unquote moment arm for the gain velocity vector has a length of simply R over 2. Thus, R over 2 times V sub F is equal to R times V naught. This is just a two-variable, two-equation system. We can quickly solve this using substitution, and we have V0 squared is equal to 2/3 gr sine theta. Of course, one could have also answered the value of V sub F as the steady state velocity, because in the steady state, the velocity is really jumping back and forth between these two in each of the rotations and collisions. And just like that, with a bit of elementary physics, we've reached the goal for this video. What makes this problem seemingly difficult is finding the strategy to discovering the steady state velocity, and once you have that down, it's just writing equations. Alright, now that we've solved it, I'll end this video with some exercises. I previously stated that we are assuming the hexagon doesn't fly off the plane due to a shallow angle. Try to find what angle condition is really necessary for this. If the angle is too large, gravity won't provide sufficient centripetal acceleration, so it could lose contact. Moreover, if the angle is too small, the hexagon may come to a stop. What's the minimum angle for the terminal velocity to be non-zero? And with that, I'll end the video. Happy holidays and see you in 2021.